Then came a moment when people understood, when people, the risks became evident again. The housing bubble started to deflate, all of a sudden things got dangerous. Lately people have taken to calling it the Minsky moment, because a lot of what I'm saying is the late Hyman Minsky had this theory, but alternatively, I always prefer the Wile E. Coyote moment, because according to the laws of cartoon physics, you need to run five steps, it's only when you look down that you plunge. And what happened then was all around the Western world, there was a huge shift towards trying to pay down debt, huge shift towards deleveraging. In some cases, forced people, highly indebted players were forced by their creditors to cut back drastically. In other cases, not forced, but prudential, or you know, people saw the trouble that other people had gotten into. All around the world, all around the advanced world, basically, people are trying to pay down debt, trying to spend less than their income. And that's where the problem comes. Because the world economy is a closed system, it all adds up. Your spending is my income, and my spending is your income. And if both of us try to cut our spending below our income, we have a problem. In fact, we have a depression. And what we found ourselves in is a depression. It's not the Great Depression, not yet anyway. Hopefully not. But it's clearly the same kind of thing, if in a somewhat milder form. It's a situation where the world is awash in productive capacity that for which there isn't enough demand to make use of it. It's a wash in savings that no place to go because the amount that people want to save is more than the amount that businesses and others want to invest. It's just a situation where enormous amounts of productive capacity are going to waste. But that's way too antiseptic sounding. Yes, I mean, there's probably $1 trillion a year of goods and services that the U.S. economy could be producing each year that it isn't because we're depressed. But in a way, that's the least of the problem. It's also mass unemployment. It is hard for those of us who have relatively sheltered lives to grasp but just how bad it is. But certainly here in the United States, we have a system that basically does not allow for people to be unemployed for long periods of time. We have no safety net, really, for people who are without work for a long period of time. And in normal times, we don't have a lot of people who have long-term unemployment, but now we do. So now we have like 4 million people who've been out of work for more than a year, which is catastrophic. It's just the amount of human damage that's being done is enormous. What do we know about slumps that follow financial crises? Well, they're different. When you have a recession like 1981, 1982. That was a recession that was imposed more or less deliberately by the Federal Reserve. It said, you know, inflation's running out of control, we've got to slam on the brakes. They raised interest rates, the economy plunged, inflation fell, and then they said, okay, well, we think we've inflicted enough pain, and they relaxed it, and the economy sprang back. And it was morning in America, actually. Something like this doesn't work that way. You've got an overhang of debt that's sitting out there, you've got for a long time, we had excess housing, although we pretty much worked off that inventory. But it just there's no quick route to recovery. And history says that typically slumps that follow a financial crisis go on for a very long time. And there's a fine line you need to draw there between saying that they do tend to go on for a very long time can make you think that they have to go on for a very long time, and that's what's not true. Because there is actually a very simple solution, which is, yeah, everybody in the private sector is trying to cut back and spend less, but we have this thing called the government. And the government could and should be stepping up and providing, not forever, but should be engaged in deficit spending to sustain this economy while people get those debt burdens down, while they get back to normal times. And to a certain extent, that happens just automatically. If you ask, why isn't this the Great Depression? Why aren't we completely replaying the 1930s? The biggest reason is simply that we have a big government. And although the economy plunges, the Social Security checks keep on coming, and the Medicare payments continue to be made, and that's kind of acted as a buffer, a flywheel, or whatever. It's stabilized. But what we should have been doing is much more in the way of additional support. What we've actually been doing, we did some of that. We had a stimulus, which sounds like a big number, 800 billion, except 100 billion of it was stuff that would have happened anyway. A good part of the rest was tax cuts, which weren't effective. And always bear in mind that the US economy produces $15 trillion worth of goods and services each year. So it was actually way too small given the size of the crisis. And critically, after doing some things to try and fight this depression in 2009, here and around the Western world, we turned our backs on that and got obsessed with the deficit, got obsessed with cutting spending, and have perpetuated this thing. And so it's gone on and on and on. The purpose of this book I wrote was to try and change that mindset, put a little bit of a fire underneath, say that this does not have to be happening, because it really doesn't. It could be over. Probably some of you know, I said if we discovered a threat from space aliens that required an abrupt buildup, you know, somehow, hopefully the kind of space aliens that you have to fight by rehiring school teachers, then this depression would be over before you know it. And if we then discover, oops, there weren't actually any space aliens, we'd nonetheless be much better off for the experience. The point is that the obstacles to a quick recovery are political and they're intellectual. It's just a lack of clear thinking. It's a lack of course, the unwillingness to admit that some of the orthodoxies that have dominated our political discourse are wrong. Getting stuff to actually happen is not so easy, and it's an interesting question. We have this election coming up, you may have noticed, and exactly who will be in charge is uncertain, and whether he will have the freedom of action that we want is also uncertain. But I think it really is important to keep on pushing and saying this is a vast human financial catastrophe that is completely gratuitous. It could be ended very quickly. It could be ended very nearly painlessly if only we got our heads straight. And so that's what I've been trying to get done. And let me, with that, throw it up for questions. Yeah, since we're being filmed here, but I'm not sure how we do this. We have the one mic, and so it roams. Okay.
We're going to try to take. Let's take questions. We have a very short period of time with Professor Graham Stewart.
If the solution is easy, what is it? Okay. If the solution is easy, what should we be doing?
Okay.
Just repeat the question.
So, yeah, all right, I'll just repeat the question. The question is, if the solution is easy, what should we do? The answer is actually, for the most part, just spend more. There are some other things that we could be doing. Mortgage debt relief could help. Unconventional monetary policy, you know, I've been trying to bully my former colleague Ben Bernanke into doing even more than he's doing. But mostly, and as it happens, one of the things is, in 2009, you said, well, stimulus, what are we going to spend on? And you worried that things like, that some of the things that you might want to do would take too long to get going. But at this point, since our policy has been so misguided, you can get a lot of bang just by reversing the mistakes we've made in the last 2 years. Above all, state and local. What we've had is huge cutbacks at the state and local level because of budget constraints. With another slug of federal aid, we could rehire the 300,000 school teachers that have been laid off. We could restart the road projects that have been canceled and the repair work. And at this point, there's really no question that if you did that, you could bring the unemployment rate well below 7% very, very fast. So if you ask what would I like, first off, I'd say $300 billion a year of temporary aid to state and local governments so they can rehire those school teachers.
Okay. We have a question.
Yeah, I'm just going to take the questions and repeat them. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so I'd like if the space aliens were to come here, I'd like that. What if, is it possible that climate change could be those space aliens, and how can we use that as some sort of
Yeah. So the question is, could climate change serve as the economic stimulus? Or concern about it? Yeah, if you could persuade. I mean, there's this problem, right? You've got, we have half the political spectrum that doesn't believe in climate change, actually doesn't even believe in the theory of evolution, which is kind of hard to get anywhere. But yeah, I mean, one of the things I had was hopeful about. One of the odd things here is that if you actually had a climate change regime put into place phasing in. If we actually had a cap and trade or whatever to if that was an announced policy and you knew it was going to phase in, there would be a lot of incentive for businesses to start investing now in changing the way they do business, which would be exactly what the doctor ordered. You can't think of a better time to get people investing in pollution control equipment and new forms of energy than right now. Realistically, politically, I try to think about what might actually happen. I think aid to rehire school teachers is something that might happen. Unfortunately, climate change, we've got so many people so dug in on disbelief that we're talking about an education program of years to get there.
Any other questions? Let's do them aside.
I'm sure that a lot of us have shared your frustration over the last 4 years. In fact, you've probably contributed to our frustration.
Right.
Do you have any sense, if the president is reelected, that he has learned something out of these 4 years and that we could anticipate, if not him naming you as head of the Council of Economic Advisors, some real departure in the second term?
Yeah, so the question is, do we think that Obama's learned something, and if he's reelected, he would try to do something more? Yeah, the answer is yes, I think so. Actually, last fall, a year ago, they came out with the American Jobs Act, which was smaller than I would have liked, but bigger than I expected, and it was actually a major favorable surprise. Now, of course, it wasn't going to turn into law, but it did show that they'd finally gotten over the fear that they need that any major proposal couldn't be launched because people would accuse them of blowing up the deficit. So no, if you actually the actual analysis coming out of the White House is much better. They've gotten past that they for a while there Obama was sharing in that premature deficit obsession, but I think at least as economics people are past that. So no, I would be actually quite hopeful about what they might do. And we would have if the Jobs Act had been passed, the unemployment rate would be below 7% right now. Mm-hmm. So just bear in mind that we are things would be a lot better right now if Obama the revitalized Obama that we started to see last year if he'd been able to get his agenda through. Mm-hmm.
Deandra?
When you say that the solution is to spend more, do I understand by that that the deficit is sort of a fictitious monster in your mind? Mm. And are you not worried about the devaluation of the dollar and against other currencies? And I am a little
So is the deficit something not to be worried about? What about devaluation of the dollar? The deficit, in the long run, the government has to pay its way. But as favorite quote from John Maynard Keynes, in the long run, we're all dead. More to the point, that now is not the time to be doing that. The time to be running budget surpluses and paying down debt is when the private sector is strong, when the economy is strong. We should have been running surpluses in the middle years of the last decade. We weren't. But the time that, okay, the real relevant Keynes quote, John Maynard Keynes, the guy who figured this out, 80 years ago, and we should have, if only we still remembered that, we'd be in much better shape. The boom, not the slump, is the time for austerity. The time to start controlling spending and raising taxes is, leaving aside some political, I would like to see those high-end tax cuts revoked, but mostly as a political position. But the time to be trying to control the deficit is once the private sector is ready to spend again. Then the government can withdraw its support, get its own financial house in order without throwing the economy back into depression. Premature austerity is really what you don't want to do. That's what FDR was talked into trying to balance the budget in 1937, sending the Great Depression into a second downward leg. He actually had quite strong recovery for his first 4 years in office, and then he made the mistake of listening to the deficit talks too soon. So the answer is eventually, but not. I actually end up quoting St. Augustine also. Oh Lord, make me chase the continent, but not yet.
Right.
This is
Neil uses it.
Yeah. The other and about the devaluation. No, I mean the people have been warning about runaway inflation now for 4+ years. It's not going to happen under these conditions. How are you going to have runaway inflation when people are unemployed and can't demand wage increases? And any devaluation of the dollar against other currencies, hey, that's good. That makes our exports more competitive. Now, we would actually like that. I'd be calling for doing that as a deliberate policy, except that the other people is in large, to a large degree, the Europeans who've got problems of their own. So it's not clear. They want a weaker euro, we want a weaker dollar, and we can't really both get that.
Okay, let's go one question over here, and then we'll go back to over here.
So speaking of the difficulties of persuasion, and reiterating the point, the question that Jan just asked about the deficit bogey, how do you, since the executive cannot on its own do kind of change direction, how do you change the political climate in the country such that the other side can begin to see that this is something that shouldn't be dealt with now, but maybe later on down the line.
You have 2 minutes on how to change the.
Yes, a combination of sweet persuasion and vicious ridicule, I think, is the approach. I think it's really important. I mean, one of the things that has happened, I'm in a peculiar state of mind here, actually, which is that the policy situation has been incredibly frustrating, the political situation, but the economic analysis, people doing basic, well, amounts of textbook economic analysis, like me, but also others, my God, the things work. I mean, we came into this unprecedented situation, stuff we haven't seen for 75 years, with a bunch of very counterintuitive predictions, that budget deficits would not cause interest rates to go up, that printing money would not cause runaway inflation. For the prediction, which was made in advance that this would be a prolonged slump, the prediction that austerity measures would do terrible things to European economies that were imposing harsh austerity, all those things, the stuff has worked beautifully, and the track record. If we have a policy debate, and it turns out that one side of this policy debate has been right about most things, and the other has been wrong about everything. And I think that is a somewhat helpful, it actually does persuade at least a few people now and then.
There's a question here. And is there anyone while we're there? I want to make sure we get balanced.
My question is on the conditions of the devaluation of the dollar.
Yeah.
Isn't it true that 2 years ago, China and Japan will no longer accept the dollar as a payment? And if more countries do that, then they will not be able to pay back by printing the money.
Please.
Yeah, so the question was whether China and Japan are going to stop accepting the dollar. No, nothing like that. No, the dollar plays a special role in the world system. It is the currency that people use, in the interbank market. If you're going to exchange Greek drachma, there aren't any Greek drachmas anymore, sorry. If you're going to exchange Peruvian currency for Mongolian currency, the banks are not actually going to try and find a matching deal. They're going to run the transaction through dollars, which is very interesting and leads to fascinating research and is of absolutely zero importance in the real world. It just doesn't matter for any of these issues. The international world of the dollar is just not... This is what people make up all kinds of reasons to be afraid of trying to move us to full employment, and they're really just not there. This is not our problem, and we should be very afraid of the corrosive effect of long-term unemployment on us, our society, and we should be ignoring all the people who are saying, oh, there's this mysterious technical economic financial thing that somehow makes it impossible to create jobs. It's just not right.
In the back.
Where will the European Union be in 2 years?
Oh, boy.
We have only a minute and a half on that one.
Yeah. Okay. Depending on, I guess, what kind of dreams I had the previous night, I have two points of view. On current policy, Europe is headed for catastrophe. It's impossible. What they're demanding of the debtor countries is impossible. The extreme austerity, drastic cuts in wages to restore competitiveness, which of course makes their debt burden worse because their income is down, but the debt isn't. That's not going to work. So if you look at it that way, you say you're heading for disaster and things are going to break up. On the other hand, European elite, everybody well informed in Europe is aware of what a catastrophe, a failure of the euro would be. That it would take a 60-year project, the European project of democracy and peace through economic integration, and would throw it into the trash can, and would discredit all of the people that you really want to to be playing a role in public life. You look at Greece, and you have government of national unity, which is the whole spectrum of reasonable opinion. And if they fail, then what you're left with is, well, first the hard left, which are maybe tolerable, but then after that, actual fascists. So the European elite understands that. Angela Merkel understands that. So when I'm feeling optimistic, I think that in the end, they will do what they need to do to save the European project, even though at the moment they all insist that they won't. I have slightly better than even odds that they will, partly because I'm actually a great admirer of Mario Draghi, who's turned out to be a very clever, very subtle guy, and I think actually gets it, though he can only push so far at any given time because of the political situation. But wow, and what a mess they created. If we can have fantasies, I want a time machine. So I can go back to 1992 when they were signing the Maastricht Treaty, burst into the hall and say, don't do this, you're not ready for a single currency.
And for unanimity. All right, we only have about 5 minutes left for a couple of questions, so we're on the couch.
Yes, the reality is that the vast majority of people simply don't know enough about economics to do more than just use a few simple slogans and maxims that they learn. Things like, you can't live on debt, you can't spend your way out of debt, that sort of thing. And the thing that frustrates me terribly, especially when I read books like yours, are that you're absolutely right in what you say, but unfortunately, it doesn't boil down to simple maxims. It's not the sort of thing that you can talk about in a bar.
So what's the question? Okay.
So the question is, and maybe this is a request, can you please try harder?
Yeah.
More simply. And I'd like to actually suggest, a trivialization for you. And that is that when the people are saving, the government must spend. When the people are spending, the government must save.
Yeah.
Teach people trivializations like that.
Well, that's all right. Take that under advisement. I think it's a great response.
All right, we may have one more question. Right here.
Okay.
Last question, then we'll have a summation.
Hi.
I don't look like Candy Crowley.
I know you've written about this before, but given, as you said, that inflation did not occur, and given the actual cost of Treasury bonds these days, what would it cost the U.S. government to actually invest in our physical infrastructure in a serious way?
Okay, the question is, what would it cost to invest in our physical infrastructure in a serious way?
As well as the social
infrastructure. And the answer is, it's... essentially, the funds are free, right? I mean, the U.S. government, 10-year index bonds, which are protected against inflation, so which is the right measure, right? The real cost of government borrowing currently have an interest rate of minus 0.8%. Right? People are actually willing to pay the U.S. government to take their money and keep it protected against inflation, but no more. And the funds are free, and there's a fundamental reason for that. This is not because there's some quirk. It is across the Western world, really across the whole advanced world, because Japan is part of this too. There's a lot of people want to save, they want to pay down debt, and the private sector doesn't see enough investment opportunities to make use of all of that. So there's basically all this funds looking for some place to go, begging the government to go and spend it usefully. Take some of this money, fill those potholes, rehire those school teachers, put the damn second tunnel under the Hudson River, which is very important to me. But this is insane. In fact, in general, look, we have essentially free money and free labor because the construction workers you use on these projects would otherwise be unemployed. There is absolutely no reason, even aside from the job creation desirability of spending more, not to be doing a lot of infrastructure right now. One of the things that I guess can drive me a little crazy is you look at what we're actually doing and the situation and the fundamental insanity of what passes for prudent policy. That at a time when we have vast amounts of unemployed labor and in effect unemployed capital, that we're cutting back on public investment. That at a time when government borrowing has never been cheaper, we're obsessed with the deficit. And the fact that the unemployment has practically dropped out of serious political discussion. So, you can go crazy because you spend all your time bemoaning what's gone wrong. But I think the answer is just keep on hammering on these things, and little by little, you make some progress in shifting the debate and eventually shifting the policy.
Thank you.
You got a short question? All right. I'm going to trust you.
Housing market. What can you do that if you think that that's one of the most important issues we launch the economy? And interest rates are not really helping because there are all our like lending standards. It's so difficult to get a mortgage, even though applications are high. Actual mortgages are not really.
Housing is. There's some things that are tricky, but the one thing that you can do right away, can do it in again, do very quickly, is the great refi. That we have now a large number of mortgages that are essentially owned by the government, that interest rates that are well above current prevailing rates, because the people don't have the down payments to qualify for a refi, and Fannie and Freddie, so we have the problem with the market. But anyway, but basically with the stroke of the pen, right away, make a big gain on the mortgage side, and then I think you have to expect the mortgage criteria are going to be tighter than they were because we've been through this bubble. But, if I was going to suggest things that might help, I'd say maybe it would be a good idea for the Fed to try to convince people that interest rates will be stayed down for a long time and to go out and buy some mortgage-backed securities. And some people know that's actually what they did. But more of that. And housing is starting to come back. It's not all... We're not condemned, even in the absence of the policies, we're not condemned to being in this state forever. Little by little, you can actually see there's been a significant improvement in the U.S. economy over the past year. Housing is starting to creep back. Household deleveraging, we're probably about a third of the way back to a sustainable level of debt. So we've made significant progress on that front. Labor market is probably about a quarter of the way back. From the worst. So, given time, this will actually heal itself. But of course, that during the time that takes, enormous amounts of waste and suffering take place. So, but push it along. And basically, on all of these things, I'd be for a kitchen sink approach. There are lots of things that might help a bit. Try all of them, and maybe cumulatively they do a lot.
One last, we have no more time, but I'll take the provision. What surprised you most in the debate in terms of the discussion of the economy?
Wow, there's so many. But no, I have to say, actually, reading over the last night's transcript, the one that struck me was, I'm sorry, but as a Times columnist, I can't do endorsements, so you have no idea who I favor in this election.
But
I was struck then by Mitt Romney describing himself as a small businessman. Because it's true that Bain Capital, when it started, had only 10 people and $37 million in funding. there's kind of a depressing absence of serious discussion.
Nothing on housing.
And I don't actually blame Obama much for that, because it is a hard thing to get across, and he has this difficult line to walk between. If he celebrates the economic progress we're making, although it's real, it comes across sounding callous because it's insufficient, and so it's a difficult position. Romney is. The big story in my neck of the woods is that he's been citing some. Reports which you say validate his economic plan, and none of the reports actually says anything like what he's claiming to say. So it's a very interesting, but it is a shocking thing that here we are, where the overwhelming problem is mass unemployment, and we're having very little discussion of that in this presidential campaign. Life isn't fair.
Well, this is what a great country this is. First, I want to thank Deanna Douglas. Professor Krugman, on his office door, and one of the great things about the accessibility of Professor Krugman is that you have office hours like every other professor. At Princeton.
Yeah, I'm like most professors, I'm sometimes there for them and sometimes not, but I always answer my email.
And on his door is a little sign of a man carrying a placard that says, "The end is still coming." So, we want to thank you for your time, and thank everyone else. Thank you.